Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In this video, we will discuss about the indirect vector control of the induction motor. In the previous videos, we have discussed about the basics of the field-oriented control, and we have discussed two methods for the determination of the rotor flux. One was based upon the voltage model, and the other one was based upon the current model. So, if you are estimating the rotor flux and the position vector, that is e raised power j theta, with the help of the voltage and the current signal that is acquired from the machine terminal with the help of the sensors, then that vector control is called the direct vector control. In the direct vector control, you use the voltage and the current signal in the direct vector control. However, in the indirect vector control, we use the speed that is measured or estimated, and from that speed we determine the rotor flux, we estimate the rotor flux, and we determine the unit vector from the information of the speed that is measured, that is the rotor speed. So the vector control, which is developed using the unit vector and the rotor flux, which is estimated using the speed that is measured from the shaft of your induction motor, that is called indirect vector control. In direct vector control, we use the voltage and the current signals. However, in the indirect vector control, we use the speed that is obtained from the shaft. So that is the difference between the indirect and the direct vector control. For the direct vector control, we have seen the two methods for the estimation of the rotor flux and the unit vector in the last two videos, and we have discussed the voltage and current model in detail. So in this video, we will address the indirect vector control. So the equivalent circuit of the induction motor in the synchronously rotating frame of reference is shown in front of you. This is the Q axis circuit, and this one is the D axis circuit. This one is representing the stator side in the Q and the D axis, and this is representing the rotor side. And this is the common inductance, that is the mutual inductance or magnetizing inductance between the stator and the rotor, in the Q axis as well as in the D axis. We have discussed the derivation of this equivalent circuit in arbitrary frame of reference, in the synchronously rotating frame of reference, in the rotor frame of reference, and in stationary frame of reference in detail in our previous videos. So this is the circuit for the synchronously rotating frame of reference. Here you can see the induced EMF because of the flux linkages of the D axis in the Q axis are based upon the speed of rotation of the reference frame, that is omega e. As we are discussing the synchronously rotating frame of reference, so our omega e will be equal to the stator speed, or will be the synchronous speed, the speed of rotation of your stator magnetic field is called the synchronous speed. So over here in the stator side, the induced EMF is based upon the speed of your reference frame. However, on the rotor side, you know that the rotor is also rotating and your stator is also rotating, so the relative difference will be responsible for the induced EMF. So this is based upon the slip. This omega e minus omega r is basically the slip speed. So into phi dr will give you the induced EMF in the Q axis because of the flux linkages of the D axis, and similarly over here the polarities in the D axis will be opposite as compared to the Q axis. And we have derived this model in detail. You can refer back to those videos and you can understand this equivalent circuit of the induction motor in the synchronously rotating frame of reference. This is the generic model that can be applied to the squirrel cage induction machine or can be applied to the wound rotor type induction machine. If we consider the squirrel cage induction machine, in squirrel cage induction machine, our rotor side is short circuited in the squirrel cage machine, Because in squirrel cage, we have the short-circuited copper bars over the rotor and the rotor terminals are not accessible. So, in this video, we will discuss about the squirrel cage induction machine and indirect vector control of squirrel cage induction machine. So, now let's look at this equivalent circuit and we write down the rotor voltage equation. So, the rotor circuit is this one. So, this voltage drop will be equal to IQR into RR plus this voltage plus the voltage between these two points. If you take the sum of these ones, sum of all voltages in the closed loop should be equal to 0. So, IQR into RR plus omega E minus omega R into phi dr, that is this voltage, plus the voltage between these two points, and that you know is equal to the derivative of the flux linkages. So, derivative of this flux linkages, that is phi qr rotor side q axis flux linkages in the synchronously rotating frame of reference, the derivative of this will be equal to the voltage between these two points. So, that should be equal to vqr, and that is equal to 0 because we are going to consider the short circuit. Why? Because we have the squirrel cage induction motor. And similarly, you can write down the equation for the d-axis, that is this voltage plus this voltage and plus the voltage between these two points, that should be equal to vdr, and the vdr is equal to 0. So, this omega e minus omega r is the slip speed of the induction motor, because omega e is the speed of the stator, electrical speed, and the omega r is the speed of the rotor, electrical speed in radian per second. So, this one is the slip speed. So, you can write down these equations in the slip speed. Okay, now let's understand the concept that we are going to apply over here. We are considering the synchronously rotating frame of reference. If your Q and the D axis are fixed, they are not rotating, that is the stationary frame of reference. The frame of reference which is fixed at the rotor means it is rotating with the rotor speed. So, that is this frame. So, this is the rotor frame of reference, and with respect to stationary frame of reference, its position will be changing, and that will be defining the rotor position, and the derivative of this one will be the rotor speed. Now, this frame of reference which is rotating at the speed omega e with respect to this reference that is fixed, this is the synchronously rotating frame of reference, and its position is theta e, and the derivative of this theta e will give us the speed omega e. So, we are considering our motor model in this frame of reference, that is rotating with the speed omega e, that is the stator speed. And if you look at these two, the difference of the angle between the stator frame of reference and the rotor frame of reference, this will be theta slip. And the derivative of this one will give us the omega slip, that is the speed difference between the stator and the rotor. The rotor frame of reference will be lagging behind the stator frame of reference by the speed that is equal to the slip speed. Okay, now let's look at this phasor diagram. If we consider the voltage vector, that is this one, and the stator current, that is this one, IS, the angle between the voltage, this is the stator voltage and this is the stator current, that is equal to, let's suppose this phi, this will be the power factor angle. Your current will be lagging behind the voltage by some angle, that is the power factor angle. And as we are considering the synchronously rotating frame of reference, so this Q axis and the D axis, they are rotating with the speed omega e. And our these space vectors are also rotating with the speed omega e. So, they will appear stationary in the frame of reference which is rotating with the speed omega e, because this frame is rotating at the same speed at which this space vector is rotating. So, if we take the projection of the voltage vector along this axis, this will be the D component in the synchronously rotating frame of reference, and this will be the Q component, right? So, those will be stationary. Those will be the DC quantities. because our space vector is rotating and our reference frame is rotating, and both are rotating at the same speed, that is the stator speed, omega e, which is the electrical speed of the stator in the radian per second. Right, so the angle between these two space vectors will be the power factor angle, and the current angle in this frame of reference, let's suppose this is equal to theta t. So now if we look at the two components of the currents, one along the d axis and the one along the q axis. So these are the two components, and in this, this is basically the d component. So we should write it IDS, that is along the d axis, and the other component is this one, the q component. So let's suppose that the component which is along d axis is IF, and the component along q axis is represented as IT. Why we are going to call it IF and IT? Because in the previous video, if you remember, we have discussed that for field oriented control, our rotor flux is kept aligned with the d axis. So that you can see over here, the rotor flux lambda r, or lambda r in the synchronously rotating frame of reference, or sometimes we will also be representing it as phi r. So that is along the d axis, and the component of the stator current which is along the d axis is the flux component of the current, because it is responsible for the rotor flux, and the component which is orthogonal to this one, perpendicular to this d component, that is called the torque component of the stator current. So our stator current has two parts. One is the field component, or the flux component, and the other one is the torque component, which is perpendicular to that one. And the component which is along the rotor flux, that is the field component, because that is going to give you the rotor flux, and controlling that one, you can control the rotor flux. So as we have discussed in the previous videos, in the FOC, field oriented control, we operate our induction motor like the DC motor. And here you can see the flux component and the torque component are independent of each other because they are orthogonal. If you will be changing this D component, this will not affect this Q component. And similarly, if you will be changing this Q component, that will not affect the D component, because they are perpendicular to each other. Right, so this is the synchronously rotating frame of reference, and we have represented our stator current in the two components, field component and the torque component, and the field component is along d axis and the torque component is along q axis. So in FOC, the rotor flux is assumed aligned with the d axis. So what about its components? Its D component will be equal to the total rotor flux, and its Q component will be zero. So phi QR, that is the component of the rotor flux along the Q axis, that is zero, and phi DR, the D component of the rotor flux in the synchronously rotating frame of reference, is equal to the rotor flux vector. Right? Okay, now let's consider the second frame of reference, that is rotating with the rotor speed. So that is shown over here with this red color that you can see. This is the q axis and the d axis, and this frame of reference is rotating with the speed omega r, and this frame of reference, this one and this one, they are rotating with the speed omega e, and we know that the synchronous speed, the stator speed, is higher than the rotor speed in the case of induction motor. So there will always be a slip. So this angle represents the slip angle, and the rate of change of this slip angle will be equal to the slip speed. Right? If you take the derivative of this one, that will be equal to omega slip, the rate of change of this one. Okay, now let's look at this phasor diagram in this phasor diagram, you can see we have considered all the frame of references. This frame of reference, which was rotating at the synchronous speed omega e, the other frame of reference that is rotating with the speed omega r aligned with the rotor, that is the rotor reference frame. And this black color is now indicating the stationary frame of reference that is fixed and is not rotating. And it is fixed in such a way that it is aligned with the ABC frame of reference, right? So we have discussed about these frames in the video where we discussed the different transformation techniques, the Clark and the Park transformation and different variants of the Park transformation. So in this case, our stationary frame is the reference and we measure the angle with respect to that one. It is fixed, it is not rotating, its speed is zero. So with respect to this, this frame DE and the QE, that is rotating with the speed omega e. So what about this angle theta F, which is also the equivalent to theta E? The position at this instant of this synchronously rotating frame with respect to the stationary frame, the rate of change of this angle theta E will give you the omega E. So this will be definitely changing at certain other instant of time. It will be like this because it is rotating with the speed omega E. So at one particular instant, this angle is theta F or the theta E. And similarly, if you look at this frame of reference, the rotor frame of reference, it is fixed with the rotor, so it is rotating with the rotor speed. So its angle with respect to the stationary frame will be theta r, and the derivative of this theta r will give you the rotor speed, right? And the difference between this rotor and the stator is the theta slip, and the derivative of this theta slip is the omega slip. So this angle theta f, that is equal to theta e, can be written as theta r plus theta slip, right? So that you can see over here, theta f is equal to theta e, that is equal to theta r plus theta slip. And we have seen that this angle theta t is the angle of the current in the synchronously rotating frame of reference from the d axis. So the angle of this current space vector, stator current space vector, in the stationary frame of reference is this theta s, and that is equal to theta r plus theta slip plus theta t, that you can see where theta r plus theta slip plus theta t, that will give you the angle of the space vector, stator space vector, current space vector with respect to our stationary frame of reference, right? And this can also be written like that, theta f plus theta t. You can write the sum of these two will be equal to theta s. So you have the set of equation for the theta s, and for theta f you will say that is equal to theta slip plus theta r, right? So this phasor diagram is giving us the detailed insight of the positions of the stator, rotor with respect to the stationary frame of reference. And we will be using these angles to estimate the rotor flux by measuring the speed of the rotor. Because when you are going to install this sensor for the speed measurement, it is going to give you the rotor speed. That is this one, the speed of rotation of this frame of reference. And if your parameters are in this frame of reference, you need to estimate the stator speed omega e. And for that, what you need to look at this theta slip. If you somehow can compute that what is this theta slip, and if you add in the theta r this theta slip, you will get this theta f or theta e. And the derivative of that theta e will be equal to the stator frequency in radian per second. So from the estimation of the speed, a measurement of the speed. You will get theta r, then you will work out for theta slip. By adding these two, you will get this theta f, the position of the synchronously rotating frame of reference with respect to stationary frame of reference. And our rotor flux in the implementation of the FOC will be considered aligned with the D axis of the synchronously rotating frame of reference. So if the rotor flux is aligned with the D axis, then we can write this equation. Over here you can see we are considering that the rotor flux is totally aligned with the D axis. So it is totally equal to the D component. There is no Q component of the rotor flux. It will always be kept aligned. And if we keep it aligned, then we can say that the stator current, the D component of the stator current ID will always be along the rotor flux and will be controlling the rotor flux, and the Q component will be available for the torque control. So D component will always be used for the rotor flux. So if we keep the rotor flux aligned with the D axis of the synchronously rotating frame of reference, we can write down this equation, and this one phi qr will be equal to 0. It means the derivative of the phi qr will be equal to 0. So that is the basic principle of the field oriented control, that we keep our rotor flux aligned with the D axis. This is the rotor flux based field oriented control. If you have the stator flux based field oriented control, in that you will keep the stator flux vector aligned with the D axis. But over here in this discussion, we will discuss with respect to the rotor flux that is aligned with the D axis. So if this is the case, now let's modify our these two equations which we have written for the rotor side. So in this, as phi qr is going to be 0, so this part will be 0, and similarly this term will become 0 because of the condition applied that we will be keeping our rotor flux always aligned with the D axis of the synchronously rotating frame of reference. So with this condition, these two terms are going to become 0, and we can write down these equations like this, right? Okay, so now from the equivalent circuit of the induction motor that we have seen above, we can write down the equation for phi qr in terms of the currents and the inductance. The common inductance is Lm, mutual inductance or magnetizing inductance, and from that the current from the stator and the rotor side is passing. And we are writing down the equation for the rotor flux linkages. For we will consider Llr, and the current through the Llr will be the rotor side current Iqr. We know that Llr is equal to Lr minus Lm, so writing it in this form, and then you can see that this term will be cancelled out and you will be left with Lm into Iqs and Lr into Iqr. So this is the flux linkage equation of the Q axis of the rotor side. And similarly, you can write down the flux linkage equation for the D axis of the rotor side. This is the magnetizing or the mutual inductance, two currents from that, and the leakage inductance of the rotor side, from that inductance IDR is passing only. So this can be written like this, and then this term and this term will be cancelled out. You will be left with this one. So this equation 9 and 10 combined together over here, we can write it like this. So we have this set of equation represented by 11 over here, that is representing the Q axis and D axis rotor flux linkages in terms of the stator currents and the rotor currents, right? Okay, now using the FOC condition that the rotor flux will be aligned with the D axis, therefore phi qr is equal to 0 and this phi dr will be equal to lambda r, so this equation 11 can be modified and can be written like that, that this phi qr is 0 because of the FOC. We are aligning our rotor flux with the D axis. Rotor flux is aligned with that one. So there will be no Q component, this will be 0. And this will be equal to lambda r, or will be equal to phi r, that is the total flux vector, rotor flux vector. Right, so we can write this equation like that. This will become 0 and this will be equal to lambda r. Now from this equation 12, we can write down this equation. We are basically working out the Q axis rotor current. That this can be written in terms of the stator current like that. If you know the stator current, you can work out the IQR by the information of this one, by minus Lm by Lr. And similarly, you can work out the D axis rotor current from this equation, and that will be equal to lambda r by Lr minus Lm by Lr into Ids. In the previous videos, we have discussed that this Lm by Lr is called the rotor coupling coefficient. That how much of the total rotor flux is basically linked with the stator side. This is the mutual inductance and this is the total rotor inductance. So sometimes you can also represent it with Kr, where Kr is the coupling coefficient of the rotor. Right? Okay, so from this equation 12, now we can write the equations for the currents like this. Okay, now let's consider the stator current from phasor diagram in synchronously rotating frame of reference. Our rotor flux is considered aligned with the D axis, and let's suppose that this is the stator current Is. It will be having two components. One will be along the D axis, the other one will be along Q axis. So this D axis component will be in the direction of the rotor flux, and will be, you can say that this component is basically controlling the rotor flux. In the case of the DC machine, you have the separate supply for the stator and the rotor, or for the field and the armature. But over here for the squirrel cage induction machine, you have the supply to the stator, and a part of the stator current is responsible for the rotor flux. And that is the D component of the stator current, which is responsible for the rotor flux. Right? And this Q component will be used for the torque control. And this is called the torque control component. So IDS is aligned with the rotor flux and is called the flux component of the stator current, and is represented as IF. Now onward, I will represent this one as IF. And IQS is along the Q axis and is called the torque component of the stator, and is represented as IT now onwards. So we can keep the flux and the torque independent of each other with the help of the field oriented control, because if we will be varying this component, the flux component, the torque component will not be affected. And similarly, if we will be varying the torque component, we can keep the flux component constant. So we can update this stator current in such a way that flux vector is not changed. Let's suppose if I say this is the new position of the stator current, this was the previous position. So if you look at this one, the D component is not changed, only Q component is changed. Similarly, if you position it over here, again the D component is fixed. Similarly over here, the D component is fixed. And if you want to keep Q axis fixed, so then you will have to keep it like that. Now you can see D component is changed, Q is fixed. And similarly, if you position it over here, Q is fixed, D is changed. Or over here, Q is fixed, D is changed. So you can keep one component constant and you can vary the other one. So it means you can keep the flux constant and you can vary the torque, and you can keep the torque constant and you can vary the flux. So you can use the flux to control the speed of your machine, keeping the torque constant. So that we will discuss later on. Okay, so over here we have made assumption, and we have used this notation, that we will be representing IDS with the IF and IQS with the IT. This is the field or the flux component, and this is the torque component of your stator current. Now if we use this equation 14, these definitions, you can say in this equation, so we are going to replace this IQS with IT and the IDS with the IF. So this equation 13 can now be written like this. IQR will be equal to minus Lm by Lr into IT, and IDR will be equal to L lambda r by Lr minus Lm by Lr into IF. Okay, now from equation 8 that we have defined above, that is the voltage equation of the Q axis of the rotor. Here you cannot see the term d phi by phi qr by dt, because we have seen that for FOC, as our rotor flux is aligned with the d component, this q component will be zero. So it's no more over here. Only you have iqr into rr plus the slip speed into phi dr. So now what we are going to do, we are going to use these definitions over here in this equation. So we are going to replace this iqr from this equation, that is equal to minus lm by lr into it, that you can see over here, and we are going to represent it like omega slip, and we are going to mark this phi dr with the lambda r, that is the definition for the FOC. Okay, now from this equation, if we rearrange, we can write the omega slip like this, and if we shift this rr over here, we can write lr by rr, and what is this? This is basically equal to the time constant of your rotor. So rotor time constant is tr, so you can represent your omega slip like this, lm into it by tr into lambda r. So you can estimate your slip speed with the help of this expression. And if you know the slip speed, you know the relationship between the slip angle and the slip speed. The derivative of the slip angle is the slip speed. So if you know about this omega slip, so that is the derivative of this one. So if you integrate both sides, so what you are going to get, you can get the information of the slip angle. So this can be calculated if you know about this one, omega slip. So how to determine omega slip? You need to know lm, you need to know the rotor time constant, you need to look at the q component of your stator current iqs in the synchronously rotating frame of reference, and the lambda r. If this information is known, you can work out the omega slip, and if you can work out the omega slip, you can find out the theta slip. And if you have measured the speed omega r, so in that, if you add omega slip, what you are going to get, you are going to get omega e. Or if you want to look at for the theta e, so for theta e, you will be calculating theta slip from this expression, and the theta r is from the measurement, because you are measuring omega r. Integrating that one, you can find out theta r, and once theta r is known and the theta slip is known, so adding these two together, you will be getting theta e. That is the position of the synchronously rotating frame of reference, and the rate of change of that one will give you the stator speed. Okay, so this was the q axis equation. Now if we use the d axis rotor equation, rotor voltage equation, that was this one that we have seen above. So in this, we are going to replace idr with the this expression. This is the current expression, idr. So we are going to use that one over here, and we are going to represent this phi dr with lambda r. So rearranging this one and simplifying, you are going to get this expression, and writing the equation in S domain, because this derivative in the S domain will be simply represented by S. So we can write down this equation like this, and if we rearrange, so we can write it like that, lambda r by tr plus s into lambda r, that will be equal to lm by tr into if, and from here, if we take lambda r by tr common, so we can write it 1 plus str, and if will be equal to lambda r by lm into 1 plus str, and from here we can write down the expression for the lambda r, that will be equal to lm into if divided by 1 plus str. So it's a first order transfer function, because we are working in the S domain. Now we have seen, or you can say, we have taken the Laplace transform of this equation. So it can be represented in the Simulink with the help of this block. You have this transfer function 1 by 1 plus str, and then the gain is lm. If the if is the input, you will get the lambda r, or you can directly write it like that, lm by 1 plus str, that will give you the transformation from if to lambda r, or lambda r by if is equal to lm by 1 plus str, right? where TR is the rotor time constant, LR by RR, and LR is equal to LR plus LM, where LM is the magnetization or the mutual inductance between the stator and the rotor side, and LLR is the leakage inductance of the rotor side. Okay, now let's look at the torque equation. The torque is given by the following expression in general. We have seen it in the previous videos. So that is the cross product of the stator flux linkages and the stator current. So if you want to write down this one in terms of the rotor flux linkages, so you will have to look at the coupling coefficient, right? So how much of the rotor flux is basically linked with the stator, the common flux between the stator and the rotor side. So LM by LR factor will be introduced over here when you are going to represent it with rotor flux linkages. And for the FOC, as we have seen previously, we are going to keep phi qs equal to zero, sorry, phi qr, this should be phi qr, that is zero because our rotor flux is aligned with the d axis. So with this, I will say that this component is zero, this one, and the iqs is equal to it, the torque component, and the phi dr is equal to phi r. So this equation, now using the terminology of the FOC, can be written like this, replacing this one with lambda r and this is with it. So let's suppose that this is the new constant kt, because lm is constant, lr is constant, number of poles are constant, right? So we can write down the torque equation like this, where kt will be defined like this. Okay, now omega m is the rotor mechanical speed in radian per second that you are going to measure with the help of the speed sensor. In indirect vector control, you look at the speed, and from the speed you determine the unit vector and you estimate the rotor flux linkages for indirect vector control. So if you measure the speed omega m from the shaft, that will be the mechanical speed in radian per second. So how to relate it with the electrical speed? You know that the electrical angle is equal to P by 2 into mechanical angle from your basics of the machine. So if you take the, if you want to write down in terms of the speed, so that will be equal to P by 2 into theta, omega m. This is the electrical speed and this is the mechanical speed or the physical speed. So omega e will be equal to P by 2 into omega m, where P is the number of poles. And we know that slip speed is equal to omega e minus omega r, where omega is the electrical speed and omega r is the electrical speed of the rotor. So now how to write down in terms of the mechanical speed? We can represent it like this. And from here we can work out for omega e. Omega e will be equal to omega slip plus P by 2 into omega m. And for omega slip, we have seen the expression in the equation 16, that is equal to LM into IT by TR into lambda R. So we can write down the omega E like this. So in other words, we can say that if you are measuring omega M and you know about this information, you can find out the omega E, that is the rotor frequency in radian per second, or the speed of the synchronously rotating frame of reference, or the speed of your stator, because your synchronously rotating frame of reference is fixed at the stator. So now how to implement this one in the Simulink? You need to have the information of IT, that is the Q component of the stator current. You need to have the information of lambda R. So IT divided by lambda R, this is represented by this block, and the gain is LM by TR. Again, it depends upon the constants of your machine. So you are going to get this term, and then omega m, the gain of that one is P by 2, and adding these two terms you will be getting omega e. So in Simulink you can implement it with the help of this block. Okay, we know that theta e is equal to the integration of the omega e. So if you add the integration block over here, 1 by s in the s domain is the integration, or simply if we represent it by this one, so you are going to get theta e. So from it, lambda r, and the omega m, you can estimate the theta e with the help of this block. This is the block that we have seen above, and we have added this part, and you are going to get theta e. So this is one Simulink block. This is the another Simulink block that is giving you theta E as the output. So this block can be represented like this, that you have IT, lambda R and the omega M as an input. And if you add integrator, so this block now can be represented like that, that you have these inputs and the theta E as the output, right? Okay, so from this equation, that was equation 19, this equation for the torque, we can write it like this. And from here we can work out the IT, the current required for this torque. So if you know how much torque is to be generated or to be developed, so for that you can find out what should be the Q component of your stator current, that is IT, if you know the information of lambda R. So if the torque is the input, lambda R is the input, this is the deviant block, then the gain block, and then another gain block, LR by LM, this will give you the IT, the Q component of your stator current in the synchronously rotating frame of reference. So you can represent it with the help of the Simulink block. Okay, now let's combine all of these blocks, those we have seen above, over here in this diagram. So this is the Simulink block we discussed, lambda R, omega M and the IQS, that is IT is the input and the theta E is the output. So that is basically this one that we have discussed over here, this block, right, this one. So that has been used over here. The output of this block is theta E. And let's suppose that we are sensing the terminal or the line currents of your induction motor, phase A, B and C. These are coming from the sensors. So let's mark it like that. Sensor is giving us this information. And in this we have the transformation. The transformations we have already discussed. So we are converting from ABC frame of reference into synchronously rotating frame of reference, and for that we need theta E. Without theta E you cannot have the transformation. So theta E is estimated from this block, and with the help of that you are getting this one. You are getting the IDS and the IQS, that is IT, and this component is IF, that is a D component of your stator current. So now we have also seen this block above, that how we can translate IF into lambda R. So that transformation or that equation will be used over here, and that will give the input to this input of your Simulink block, right? So current is sensed from the terminals, right, and it is converted into the D and Q component. D component is used and converted into lambda R using the information that we have seen above. And from the speed sensor we are measuring the speed omega M that is being fed to this block omega M from here. So lambda R is coming from here, from these currents. Omega M is coming from the speed sensor. Okay, this component is the IQS, that is IT, and with the unit delay 1 by Z we are feeding it to this block IQS, and it is giving us theta E that is being used over here. So we have seen lambda R, omega M and the IQS, and those are coming from these blocks. Okay, now we have the actual speed, and this is the reference speed which is to be maintained. So over here we have the PI controller or some other controller which is working to minimize the error between the actual speed and the reference speed, and it is giving us the information of the required torque. So this PI controller is basically the mapping over the torque with respect to the torque speed characteristics. It is giving it the reference torque which should be realized so that this speed error is going to become zero. How much torque is to be increased or to be decreased to bring that error to zero? We have seen above that from torque to IQS transformation that we have seen over here, torque to IQS, IT transformation, we need lambda R as well. So this block is representing that Simulink equation that we have seen above. The torque is the input and the IQS, that is IT, is the output, but we require lambda R. So lambda R is coming from here to this block as well. So we are estimating IT. Okay, then we are also specifying what should be the rotor flux linkages. And from there we are going to find out IF. IF will be equal to lambda r steric by lm that we have seen above. So we have the IF, the field component or the flux component of the stator current. The torque component is coming from here. And the theta E we can take it from here, and we can have the inverse transformation, that is from DE QE frame of reference or QE DE frame of reference to the ABC frame of reference. And this will be acting as the reference current, right? The actual current through the sensors is coming from this line. And over here we have the pulse generation circuit. Gate pulses for your inverters are developed, are designed or updated by looking at the difference between this IABC and IABC reference, because we want to make them same. IABC and IABC reference, we want to bring the error to zero. So inside you can say we have some controller that is working, and it is generating the gate pulses for the inverter in such a way that finally the error between these two will be zero. So from the information of the current and the speed, you have worked out for the theta E, and the theta E is being used in this block to generate the gate pulses for the inverter, and that will realize this speed that you have set as the reference and this rotor flux. So this is representing the indirect field oriented control block diagram using the equation those we have seen above, right? So we can represent it like that we have the speed input, we have the current inputs, speed omega m and the IABC, that is the reference speed, and we have the motor parameters, we have the reference flux. So with that we are going to generate IABC, and then we are going to give it to the inverter control, and the inverter control is generating the pulses which are given to the inverter power stage, and the required current is injected in your induction motor by adjusting the terminal voltage of your induction motor, right? Okay, now we have already seen the different variants of the park transformation. So if you have the ABC frame of reference currents, you can translate them into IQS and IDS in the synchronously rotating frame of reference using this transformation matrix. So this is our transformation matrix. If you know this IQS and the IDS, this IQS is the torque component, this IDS is the flux component. So taking the square of these two and under root, you will get the stator current vector. So you can represent that this IQD is equal to transformation matrix into IBC from here. So this transformation matrix is this one, and what is this IQD? That is equal to IQS IDS transpose, or in terms of the field oriented parameter, this is the torque component and this is the flux component, this one and this one, and then IA, IB and IC, the transpose of this one is this one. So you can implement or you can transform from ABC frame of reference to the DQD frame of reference in the synchronously rotating frame of reference with the help of this one. And we have seen above that what is this theta? This is basically theta E, and from the phasor diagram the theta E was equal to theta F that we have seen before. So if I go back and show you over here on the phasor diagram, over here, just look at that one. This is theta F, that is the theta E, that is the position of the synchronously rotating frame of reference with respect to stationary frame of reference at one particular instant of time. So we are using this theta F over here for the transformation from ABC to the synchronously rotating frame of reference, right? Okay, so theta F is equal to theta R plus theta slip, that is equal to theta E. So theta slip will be equal to the integration of the omega slip, and once you know the quantities in the DEQE frame of reference or QEDE frame of reference, you can convert them into stationary frame of reference with the help of this vector rotation. Right? So, in stationary frame of reference, what is IQS and IDS? This is the stator current into sine of theta s. Stator current into cos of theta s will give the D component. Let's go back and look at the phasor diagram again to understand this theta s. Just look at over here. This is our current vector, which is rotating in the synchronously rotating frame of reference with the speed omega e. So if this is the fixed frame, so with respect to this, the angle of this space vector, current space vector, is theta s, and it is definitely changing because this frame of reference is rotating. This is not fixed. What is this equal to? Theta r plus theta slip plus theta t, that is theta s, and this theta f, that is theta e, that is equal to theta slip and theta r. So this theta s is the, if you want to look at the component of the stator current in the stationary frame of reference, this component will be the D component. I can mark it IDS, stationary frame. And if I take its projection over here, this will be the Q component, IQS in stationary frame. Right? D component is Q component. So those are to be worked out with the help of this angle theta s, because this angle theta s will give us the projection of the stator current over the D and the Q axis. And that we have worked out over here with the help of these equations. This one. From QEDE frame of reference to QSDS frame of reference, stationary frame of reference. And in stationary frame, the Q and the D components are given by these equations. So reference currents for the inverter control can be generated using the following block diagram that is shown on the next page. So if you look at this diagram, what you have over here, you have the lambda r, you have the torque, the reference rotor flux and the reference torque. Right. So if you multiply it with the TR, that is the rotor time constant, and if you take the derivative of that, and then in that you are going to add lambda r and then giving it the gain 1 by Lm, you will get IF. We have seen this equation before, and using that equation you can implement this one. So from lambda r you can find out what is the required IF, and from the information of the given torque using the torque equation, torque part over n, and then the gain Lr by Lm, so you can find out It. So this is basically what IDS in rotating frame of reference, and this is IQS in rotating frame of reference. So from here you can find out the stator flux vector and the angle theta t, the angle of the stator space vector in the rotating frame of reference. You have measured the rotor speed, and from that you are going to find out theta r, that you are going to use over here. Theta r plus theta t that you have generated from here by looking at the required rotor flux and the required torque. So how to get the theta s? As we have seen in this phasor diagram before, the theta s is equal to theta slip plus theta t plus theta r. So you have this information theta r, you have this information theta t from here. So now we need to look at for theta slip, and the theta slip will be obtained by taking the it from here in the numerator, and in the denominator lambda r by tr, we have seen the equation before, into lm, equation for the omega slip. If you remember, if I go back and show you the equation for the omega slip, so basically we are using this equation. Just look at that. You can use this equation because this is the omega slip from equation 16. Lm into It by Tr into lambda r. So if this information is known, you can work out the omega slip. Lm into It, Tr and lambda. So that you can see over here in this block diagram. Lm into It, It from here divided by lambda r and Tr. So this will give you the omega slip. So expression for the omega slip is this one, that is lambda Lm into It divided by Lr into Tr. So that you can see over here, first of all we are getting lambda r into Tr from here, that is coming in the denominator, and then Lm, and in the numerator we have It. So you are going to get omega slip. If you integrate that one, you will get that slip. And if you add this theta slip in this angle, which is theta t, this part, theta r from the measured speed, and if you are adding theta slip that you have estimated looking at these parameters, so you can find out theta s. And if you know the theta s, now you can do the reverse transformation, that is from stationary frame of reference to the ABC frame of reference using the inverse Clark transformation. And these currents now will be used by your inverter control. Your inverter will realize that current in the induction motor, and the inverter will ensure that you have such a current that the speed command will be met and this rotor flux will be established. And this is FOC because in the derivation of this you have assumed that D axis and your rotor flux is completely aligned with the D axis, right? So this is the indirect vector control, because you have used the speed information, you have measured the speed, and from that you are going to estimate using this speed, you are going to implement the unit vector, cos of theta e and the sine of theta, which is will be used in the transformation. So now let's summarize this video. We have seen the indirect vector control of the squirrel cage induction machine. We have developed the equations for indirect vector control, and we have seen that we can represent them in the form of the Simulink block, and we have looked at the flow of the signals to generate the gate pulses for the inverter such that the required current is injected and the speed command and the flux command is realized. In the next video, we will discuss the Simulink model for the implementation of indirect vector control. That's all from this video. Thank you very much.